Now let's talk about the types of self-justifications. How do people justify to themselves? It is indeed a worst intellectual disease that a person can have. He thinks he knows it all, yet he knows nothing. It is a state where a person himself convinces himself that something haram is halal, and he is completely convinced by it, and he thinks he's on the right path. He forgets that on the day of judgment, Allah Ta'ala will hold him accountable. Now the first reason that a person tries to justify to himself is, at least I'm better than others. At least I'm better than others. There are people out there who are murderers, rapists. So what if I don't pray? So what if I have a little bit of alcohol every now and then? There are rapists and murderers and this, robbers and thieves and so on. I'm still better than them. They feel reassured that being better than those will grant them paradise by some odd way. Allah Ta'ala tells us in Surah Az-Zalzala, chapter 99, verse 7, so whosoever does good equal to the weight of an atom shall see it. And whosoever does evil equal to the weight of an atom shall see it. So it does not matter whether you are relatively better than others. Whatever bad you have done, you will pay the price for it. So we should not be in this misconception. When we commit haram or neglect Islamic duties which are farz, we think that at least we are not as bad as the others around us who are committing much bigger sins. And at least doing something Islamic is better for us, and we might be saved by it. The second point is, we say that I will change in the future. I don't want to change now, I'll change in the future. When I'm old, I do my Hajj, I'll pay my zakat, I'll pray to Allah to forgive my sins, and somehow Allah Ta'ala will forgive me and I'll be saved. I'll change in the future, not now. The Holy Prophet said, the clever one is he who disciplined himself and worked for what is after death. And the feeble one is he who followed his desires then made vain prayers to Allah. It mentions in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, chapter 62, verse 8, say, the death from which you flee will truly overtake you. Then will you be sent back to the knower of all things, secret and open. And he will tell you the truth of the things that you did. So we do not have a guarantee when we will die, yet we are boldly saying, I'll change in the future. What if you don't have that time? Life is short. You never know. It mentions in Surah Al-Mu'minun, chapter 23, verses 99 to 103, until when death comes to one of them, he says, O my Lord, send me back to life, in order that I may do good in that which I have left behind. No, it is but a word that he speaks, and behind them is a partition until the day that they are raised up. Then, when the trumpet is blown, there will be no more kinship among them that day, nor will they ask of one another. Then those whose scales of good deeds are heavy, they are the successful. And those whose scales of good deeds are light, they are those who lose their own selves. In hell they will abide. So time is short. I will change tomorrow, day after tomorrow, maybe a year later, 2 years later, who knows. We might not get that time. The third point is, I'm not ready for it yet. It's too difficult to change. People say this only when they are too much used to their existing lifestyle. When they don't want to change it, they have time for everything else, for sports and this and that, but they don't have time for Islam. They become lazy when it comes to Islam. They don't want to change. They don't want to change their lifestyle. We need to realize that in order to become good Muslims, we have to live our life according to what Allah Ta'ala has asked us to do. Islam was not revealed for angels, it was revealed for humans. Allah Ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 282, Allah does not place a burden upon a person except that which he is capable of. So Allah Ta'ala will not burden you more than you can withstand. Look at the examples of people who convert to Islam, leaving their families, their religion, their friends, their culture, their entire lifestyle, and convert to Islam. and become great Muslims and then try to spread Islam as well. Look at the example of the Sahaba who were practicing all kinds of sin before Islam came. But as soon as Islam came, they became the best of mankind. So people can change. In your own lives, you will know of people who were very notorious before, but became very good after the knowledge of Islam came to them. It is possible to change. Even if a person is going at a completely 180 degrees, he can change. Islam has the power to change and influence a person. Abu Huraira narrated that the Holy Prophet said, people are like mines of silver and gold. The best of them in the days of ignorance, of Jahiliyyah, are the best of them in Islam when they attain the knowledge. This hadith means that no matter how far you are from Islam, you have the potential to change. No matter where you are going, no matter how messed up your life is, you can change. It's still doable, it's still possible. The fourth whisper is, as long as I'm pure from the inside, Allah will forgive me. As long as I'm pure from inside, Allah will forgive me. As if Allah Ta'ala has given you a certificate that if you are pure, I will forgive you. As if there is something mentioned in the Holy Quran that if you are pure, yet you are committing sins, Allah will forgive you. There is nothing like that. It is only a delusion. It is the path of error that the Shaitan has adorned for us. Being pure does not mean that you just believe in Islam. That you know that Islam is a religion and yes, yes, it's true, I know. It means you practice it. You don't just believe in Allah, you submit to Allah. What would be the point of the Quran, the Sunnah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if everyone on the basis of their purity, no matter what sins they were actually committing, was going to go to Jannah? What would be the point? It will be too late to change on the Day of Judgment when everyone will be worried about themselves, when the earth will narrate what you have done on this ground, when your body parts will narrate what you had done. Forget being pure from inside. Your hands, your feet, your everything will narrate what you did. It mentions in Surah An-Nisa chapter 4 verse 18, of no effect is the repentance of those who continue to do evil deeds until death faces one of them and he says, now I repent, nor of those who die while they are unbelievers. For them we have prepared a painful torment. So it is not going to happen that you do sins all your life and then when death is upon you, you say, now I repent and I now want to change my life. It's not going to work that way. You've got to be true to yourself. Be honest with yourself. Don't let Shaitan influence your life. You've got to take control of the situation and realize that this world is a test for you. And the Shaitan is busy doing his best to misguide you, to put false ideas in your head and thoughts in your hearts that might be totally against Islam. The biggest test is trying to get you to fail that test. The biggest test of your life is trying to get you to fail that test. You've only got one chance. Once you die, you cannot ask Allah to do a retake. That's not going to happen. Choose a side today. Choose a side today. Not tomorrow, not day after, not a week after, not a month from now, not a year from now. Choose a side today. Either you are on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or you are listening to the whispers of Shaitan. Make a choice. Make a choice right now.